And we are in session 31, and we will look into some of the ASP.NET fundamentals today. So we did see a sweet flavor of HR project implementation using intrinsic and out-of-box controls without doing much of a coding. So today we will look into some of the ASP.NET fundamentals, which includes your building the project following the multi-layer design that we have laid out in the first place to start with. And the application demo, I have mapping the design, so I will show you a demo of the application that is done partly, and we'll see map that design to the map that code to the design. And we'll see the Enterprise Architect tool, how it can use to generate the code out of the design, and code reverse engineering, how we can do in using the Enterprise Architect tool. We'll see an ASP.NET fundamentals, like what is it all about and history of ASP.NET evolution over a period of time. We'll see a lot of interesting features or interesting things you might want to know. And we'll see a difference between ASP.NET MVC and ASP.NET Web Forms programming models. So we'll see some of the overview of MVC as well. We'll see ASP.NET request processing architecture, which is a deep dive into how the request is handled, a request and response is handled in general from client to server and server to client. We will look into the IIS overview with version history of IIS, how it is evolved and what are the different versions we have in the market, and what are the improvements have been done over a period of time. And we'll specifically map to IIS version 6.0 and 7.5 and compare its request processing architecture in detail. We'll deep dive into how the request processing architecture looks like in 6.0 and 7.5 especially. And also we will have some more items. We'll cover what is the HTTP context. We'll see what is a HTTP request, HTTP response, HTTP application object, global.asax, session state, ASP.NET trace diagnostic information, which is profiling, ASP.NET page lifecycle, and all these fundamentals of ASP.NET we'll cover in this session, which is a very, very valuable and a very important session to talk with. Okay, so let's get into all these details now. So we're going to continue with our last session with our HR project. Probably a couple of more sessions or we're going to wind this up. And so just want to recap on where we were last time. We have done a project almost done with I think I have I'll just open the project that we were working on. I'll get rid of this slide here. Okay, so we were, yes, so this is a project that we have been working so far. And just to refresh our memories, we have almost done the project, but using very shortcut things, using your data grids and auto-generating the code and things like that, which was not actually matching with our design. So I'm just going to quickly run that application, what we have done so far, in which we have implemented the authentication part. And I'm going to log in. So we did complete the authentication part and also the authorization part. And so this is the admin screen, but most of the screens were not done. And most importantly, we were able to do the department module and also the employee module, but of course using the details view and the grid view controls. And we're able to do this in a very quick way. So the intention for our continuation of this session is to make sure that we work in the right way. That means follow the design that we have laid out in the beginning. I'm going to recap again on the design that we had. I will quickly jump into the last portion of it wherein we had the the class diagrams. Okay, so where do we start with? I think this package diagram, we did cover through the package diagrams wherein we have the domain object model as one of the package, the helpers, and the database, the data access layer implementation, business workflow layer implementation, and the user interface layer. And we did also have the class diagrams that have the HR domain base at the center and the interface for business rules implementation. That's iBusiness rules, and we have all the domain specific classes like employee address and department inheriting the domain base class and interface and implementing the business rules. And we have a couple of containment relationship with the address class. And we did actually, I don't want to again walk through the whole details now, so we're going to quickly jump into how to transform this whole design that we had in the EA model. So in this case, I'm pretty much using the Enterprise Architect as a case tool to design and generate the code out, but there are certainly a wide variety of tools available for the same. Okay, so including the Visual Studio has an architectural edition that can help us in creating these class diagrams, but of course it's tightly coupled with the code components. And yes, so this is our old project, which is right now we're not going to be using it. So what I'm interested in is the new project. And so far I have worked on this project pretty hard and try to finish this the best of my available time, and here we have today. So it this one combines with multiple flavors. I try to bring in a lot of flavors into this project so that I could cover as much as I can within our limited resources, that is our time and our energy. Okay, and so what I have here is the two versions of our application. One is the grid view and data details view version, which we have done in the last one, and the other one is the, I would like to go have a close look at this. Okay, yeah, so this is one of the flavor which we have seen so far, which is the grid view and details view flavor, which has a very limited coding and of course very limited functionality and very limited flexibility to do many things. And the other one is the BWL and DAL, that is your business workflow layer and data access layer approach, which is closely matching to our design, the original design. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly run this program. Okay, we'll run through the program, we'll see what I have done so far and what are the placeholders that I left for you to work around once you get this code out. So again, so this is not a full-fledged trouble-free application. This is again in a development version, but it is, I have a couple of functionalities implemented and a couple of functionalities I left it open so that you can implement them and learn from your leisure time. Okay, and here you go. So it's the same login screen. I have the same login screen. I'm using my user authentication login. And I have added a couple of interesting images. I just browse through Google and find whatever I feel better. Bring some kind of good UI look and feel. But again, this is not up to the mark. You can do a lot of things. As I said, this is again limited to my available time. And I have a HR logo here. Human resources probably belongs to someone else on the internet. But anyway, I'm using this for the demo. And this is the home screen. So soon after I logged in, I have this home screen. And about screen, I have again another decent image. Again, I'm trying to match with the color aesthetics, wherein I pick all the images that are in blue in color. So the home also has a blue colored picture, and the about, I did not put any text there, but again, it's up to you. You would like to put some static text there. And the admin module, we have another blue image called admin team. And the after the following the admin screen, we have the old flavor, which is the grid and the details view, wherein we have the manage employees. This is open for you. Last time we did the same department module, and the employee module is open to you. You can implement this part. And this is the department module, wherein we have both the department on the left hand side and the address table on the right hand side, and I can go and modify any of these elements here. I will say market, I'll say markets. I'll just remove the S just to demonstrate, okay? And it's able to successfully modify the departments, and also we'll try to create a new department. It's always jumping upside, but again, that's fine. It's again not too full-fledged one, but it's fine for our exercise. And watch what department I would like to give here. And thinking of something, say network. And the location, I pick one of the location here. We'll say some 35, and say insert, and we have the network record created. So I could able to manage the department information here, and similarly I could able to manage the same address information as well. Okay, so this is straightforward. This is known. We have done this similar thing in the other project, so this is not something new. So what's new here is the this screen. So this is what adheres to our whole design, which is mapping to the domain object model and everything. So before I jump into the source code and walk you through each and every line, I would like to do this demo now. So I do have a couple of records created here, and first of all I go and create a new record, and this brings me to this screen wherein I can manage the employee. That means create a new employee. In this case I'll try to create a new employee. The name, I would say some name. So Patrick Samuel, some name, okay. 07/1975. Okay, so before I do anything else, I hit save. So now I see the validations are fired, and I have the validation exceptions written out. And since all the stars, the red stars I have, whichever fields have the red marks, that's the usual standard things that stands for it's required. And if you see the error below, if I don't enter, I see an error displayed saying that please enter the last name or please enter the first name. So there's a client-side validation happening here. I'm going to hit save. And I see a lot of other errors coming up with, like, first name is important, first name is required, invalid email ID, although I did not put an email ID, but it's it should be saying that because it's again that's kind of a flaw. In other words, I would say otherwise email ID is an optional field, but still it's trying to validate. So there are a couple of flaws in the code, but you know, anyway, I hope you understand. You need to bring it to the best way you can. And the of course all these validations are fired. That's the summary I just wanted to cover at this point. And I'm going to have a record saved. First of all, Patrick, I'll say Samuel, and I'll put something for sex, and the department number 12. Ideally, in this case I'm trying to put some text. Ideally you can make this as a drop down so that you can see the departments from the other department table and have a drop down. I did not do that. So you can actually add that functionality as well. It's pretty simple. You can have a drop down box and have a query attached to it to get the unique department names into it, and that's how we can attach it to it. Pat dot CSAM. For this time, I'm going to put an invalid email ID just to test it. Okay, some phone number, and at this point again, I will try to hit save and see whether it's trying to validate that. Yes, it's it says invalid email ID, and I'm going to fix that. Okay, I'll say Sam at whatsam.com. It doesn't matter. All it cares is whether it follows the pattern or not. And the mailing address, it says mailing address is mandatory. Although it did not specify that each of these fields, it did not check. It altogether, it treated the whole thing as an object, and it specified that the mailing address is required. That's an interesting point to note. And here I'll say Sam Street and Sam City, and state I would say NJ, and zip code, some zip code, it's a 5-digit zip code. And the text box also has some validations at this point, that it doesn't allow you to enter more than 5 digits, and similarly for state. So this is again everything at the client side. And permanent address, I'm leaving blank for now, and I hit save, and I have this record added up here. That's Patrick, ID is 107. So this part is working good, and if I go back and try to edit it, I'm able to successfully retrieve that information, and it's open for editing. And what I'm going to do here is I'm going to change the department from 12 to 11, and also Patrick to say Bond, some name, okay, Bond Samuel. And also the street address side, would say again Bond Street. Sam Street became Bond Street. Okay, and that's all I'm going to say. Just want to test to see if the address is getting modified, and also the employee information is getting modified. And I see the Patrick turned to Bond here, and although I can't see the mailing address here, because this is just dumping the records that I have in the database. Ideally speaking, you need to have a query that can join with the address table and get the address also into this. For now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make use of the grid views, wherein the mailing address here, this will show me the details. In this case, I can able to see the 40 changed to Bond Street. Okay, so still I have a workaround with this application. I am able to manage the department and address information from the grid views and the details views. So this is again an ideally typical scenario where you can actually make use of this flavor versus that flavor. In a case like a department, which is like a master data, which is very simple to manage, we have an ID and name and a couple of very few fields and few validations that you need to do, you can always go with this approach wherein you can have the data grid view and also have the details view and things like that. It's going to be very simple to develop this one. And when we get into a very complex screens like an employee screen wherein we have a lot of fields and a lot of validations to fire, a lot of business rules that can go under. In such cases, it's always good to go with the domain object model route. Okay, so in this case, what I'm going to do from now on is I don't want to get into the code right now. This is just a demo I gave you. So before we get into any further details, how I did this code and what is the code looks like, I'm going to start over from the scratch again, because I know that I did some work here, but how did I do this? To show that, I'm going to start all over from the scratch. Okay, to say close the current one and also this one. Just good. Okay, so from the scratch, what does this mean? This mean is that I'm going to go back all the way to our UML diagrams, which is our enterprise architect that we have created the domain object model. The domain object model is created in the Enterprise Architect tool. That's what we have in the slides as well. And in this case, the DOM, we have this. This is our initial design that we have done. So the next important step we will be getting into is the creating the code out of this. So the design is approved. So this is the phase we are in when we last left. And now what we're going to do is generate the code out of this. So Enterprise Architect tool is very pretty helpful in doing that. What I'm going to do is I'll say code engineering and generate source code. Okay, and I'm going to map to the any local path. In this case, I will just pick the temp path. See, or instead of a temp path, anyway, a temp is the shortest way I can do it. Okay. And I will pick another one, say HRPROJ EA. So this is going to create the EA code. That's the folder I have. And I'm going to pick the include all child packages, which is going to identify all the code, all the children within the package that I picked. I'm selecting all by default and generate the code. So what this did is transformed all my visual elements to a source code. And I'm going to do, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to get that part. Let us see. Temp and HR project EA model. Okay, so this is what. So it actually created me, all the folder structure that I have in the model. If you take a look at this model, it has a package for each of these layers. That's DOM or UIL or BWL or DIL. It created the folder structure as well. Okay, it's pretty intuitive. And what it did is it actually gave me the source code for each of the classes that I have in the diagram. Okay, in this case, if I take a look at the BWL, I have the employee BWC and department BWC, and it has an interface called the IHR business workflow layer, and I have all those three elements created here. Okay, so what's the next step now? So now we have the source code created, and what I need is the project that need to be created. So EA did its job, but it did not create a project for you. So we need to actually create a new project and include all of these into our new project. So for that, I'm going to just copy this path, open the Visual Studio, okay, I'll say a new project. So in this case, of course, we are working with a web project, so I'm going to start with the ASP.NET web application, and the path that I'm interested here is that path, okay, so the path that I picked it. Okay, I'm not worried about the names at this point, so I'm going to just create them. So I have this web project, and now I have to include the source code that I have created from the EA. How I'm going to do that? I'm going to do is add a new project, because I want to keep all my multi layers as an individual assemblies. I don't want to include all those individual files into this, although you can do that as well. Doesn't make any big difference. Technically, you can actually include all those folders into this project and use them the way you want it. But the best way I would like to do is for making my component reusable across multiple other tiers, I can make them as a separate projects. So I'm going to have a new project. And remember, all of those, I'm going to make them assemblies, so I'm going to make them into a class library. Okay, So now I'm going to pick the C# template for class library, and in this case I'm going to name this as I would say DOM for domain object model. In other words, I'm going to make it specific to my project, which is HR project.dom. And where I'm going to create this, I'm going to create within the same location, which is my, I'll say within my HR project, HR DOM, and say OK. And I have these project created. If I go back to the folder where I am, so it did actually create me the HR DOM here. This is the project that is created right now. And what I want to do is bring this, I'm going to control X and dump it into this project. Okay. Ideally speaking, you normally keep, if you want to reverse engineer this stuff, then you might want to retain the same path, but again, it's not necessary or not mandatory. Okay. We can still again do the same thing and reverse engineer to the model. That also we can do. I'll demo that as well today. And yeah, this is our old project. So this is how I created all these projects. Okay, so here we are. So this is the old one. I want to again close this so that we concentrate on, okay, so web application one. Good. So from here, what I'm going to do is show all files, and I'll see all those code files. Again, class 1 is something that is created out of the standard template. I'm going to get rid of that, and I'm going to select all these files and right-click and say include in project. Okay, so my DOM project is ready, but EA is an external tool, and you cannot guarantee that the code that it gave you will be error-free. And there you go, the error started jumping in, and you have to fix those errors. Usually what happens is it might be lacking the usual namespaces, because we have the project created out of nothing. So it normally requires you to just pass on the, again, it's a date time, again, it's like a typo, because so it could be a very simple mistake. It could be either from the way you designed it, from the enterprise architect, the spelling mistake, like the date and time is capital D is what it's looking for, and things like that. So we need to just go back and fix all these business, all these errors. And of course, one by one, if we start fixing it, and again, remember, the quality of the code will be good based on the way you design it in the EA itself, because EA is just a tool, and it's trying to map the keywords that you provide. And if you are a little careful when you do the modeling there, you'll get a much better code here. Okay, so point here is that we have to fix all these little bit of code issues, and then we will be ready to consume it. So I'm not going to do all of that now. So this is how you're going to bring your code back to your from your model. Okay, and consider that I have done all that work here. I did have created the same thing with all these classes, and I have even added a couple of more, tweaked the signatures, and a lot of other things that I have did to make it happen. And finally, I have this working code done. Okay, so the DOM, it has a complete set of code implemented. It has the interfaces that we have originally designed to have, and everything is set. Now again, how this code looks like if I want to reverse engineer this code back to the enterprise architect tool. Okay, so it's going to be looking a little different. Let's see how we can do that. Okay, I'm going to close this project and create a brand new one. In this case, again, I will say, yep, I can say That's our original design, so I'm going to create a new one, HR project, reverse engineer model. Okay, this is a reverse engineer model. I'm going to pick the class diagrams and say OK. And what I'm going to do here is go to Code Engineer and import source directory. You can also import from the binary module as well. If you have a compiled binary, which is a .NET binary, you can also import using the binary module, which in this case it's pretty, it's going to internally make use of the .NET reflection and get the read the entire content and bring you the model out. This is how you can actually reverse engineer even the compiled code as well. And in this case, I'm not interested in that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to read through the code, and I have the type of code that I want to get in, and in this case I'm picking the C#, which is by default, and of course it's going to look for the CS files, okay, the code files, and where which path I need to get in. Okay, so this is my HR project. This is in the temp area, so which is not what I'm looking for. What I'm looking for is, we can always go from here, that's the best easy way. Okay, I'm going to copy the root path and go to EA and give the root path and say okay. Before you say okay, you can double check the kind of options you have, recursively process all the subdirectories or create a logical diagram for each package and so on. So you can just make, I'm choosing the default and say okay. So it's going to read all throughout the source code, and in the behind the scene it's creating the diagrams as well. The problem with this reverse engineering is that it's actually going to walk through the each and every CS files, which includes your even your email, your UI files, which is your ASPX code behind as well. So it's going to create a very big diagram, and this root packages it bring in following your naming conventions, your namespaces, in other words, following the namespace, it roots out, brings the packages created in a very structured manner. So this quality of this design is going to be reflecting to the quality of code that you have written. And in this case, as I said, it's going to even look up for the pages as well. So this is nothing but the home page with its code behind, and it tried to create the diagrams or the class diagrams for that as well. So we are not interested in the UI code behind and other things. What I'm more interested here is with our domain object model, because that's what our original design is to. So if I drill down here, I see the BWL. So this is the code, this is the design right now. After doing my code, I see the department BWC is there, and an employee BWC is there, and I have the interface available. So this is matching my original design. If I go back to my original design, so this is the BWL layer, wherein I have employee BWC, and here I have employee BWC, department BWC, and the home workflow. After doing the code changes, I did change the signatures to return a collection of int and string for error handling and other things. So in our original design, we actually did not have it. This is, you can consider this as our conceptual design. In this case, we had an array of strings to make it a little very simple. But later, when I was doing the coding, I thought it's going to be more to add the generics as well as part of the coding. So I added the generic dictionary as an return type throughout the program. And yes, so my design is still intact after doing my coding. So still I have the HR domain based class and other things. This is the whole domain object model still intact. So I'm adhering to my own design. So data access layer, so address DAC, department DAC, and employee DAC. Okay, so this is how we can get the source code into the solution. and make use of the project cycle. So this will help us in two ways. One is have our design visualized well ahead and make use of our design to generate the source code and create the model, create the source code out of it. So we will take a break with this source code. So we have seen that it's able successfully working good, except couple of exceptions. So very simple things. Otherwise, a major part it's working. We're able to create an employee record. We're able to edit the employee record, do some client side validations, and also the server side validation, and a lot of other things are there. We also have the controls created, the custom controls we have created here. And also we have user controls also created here. We have a lot of stuff that we're going to walk through in step by step in the subsequent session. But for today, what I plan to show you actually is to walk through the ASP.NET fundamentals. Without that, definitely all of this doesn't really make any sense. So we're going to quickly jump into the ASP.NET fundamentals now. Okay, so this is a kind of a reverse way we are coming in, but I almost felt like without covering any of the ASP.NET fundamentals, it really doesn't make any sense or meaning to walk through the project and finish it off. Okay, so we're going to walk through the ASP.NET fundamentals now, and in the next session we're going to jump into the coding aspects, and we'll see how each and every tier is implemented, how it is tied up together, and what are the other components that are created to make the whole project run. Okay, so we're here with the first thing, with the ASP.NET overview. We have seen it's an ASP.NET is a web application framework developed and marketed by Microsoft to allow programmers to build dynamic websites, web applications, and web services. So three things bold, you see a website, a web application. So what is the difference between a website and a web application? You should ask me if at all you have a question on that. So websites and web applications are two different things, so two different type of applications or projects that you can create in Visual Studio itself. If you go back here, let me keep this as is, and open a brand new, and if you say the website is just below the new projects, you can create a website as well. You can create a web application. You know, the web application is nothing but another project that you can create using the templates that is available here. So the idea, the major difference between a website and a web project is that the keyword itself is self-explanatory. So when you make it as a web application, it is more like an application that can run on its own, and the folder structure or the file delivery mechanism, everything is everything maps to the way the any other exe runs. When we make a web application, in simple terms, if you look at the bin folder, you will see all the necessary DLLs. For example, in our case, the way things are, if I go back to my bin directory and I see the DLLs are absolutely just like, although this is a web application, the output folder doesn't look like any web website specific thing. It's all DLLs. You get the compiled code in terms of a DLL, whereas a website, it is a more a folder based or a file based website, wherein if at all you want to add anything to the application, all you need to do is just drop the file to that folder and include it into the project. So it's a file based website. That's traditionally we used to have a websites, and in .NET you have a new option called a web application, which can be, even for example, in web application, when you refer to another project, it's going to refer to it just like any other application. The references are stored as part of the assemblies directly, whereas the references in websites are again a folder base. You just have to go and drop the file into the bin directory, and then it automatically takes it. So again, in that case, the references are not maintained as part of the project. So there's a lot of difference between a website and web application. So when will you go for a website and when will you go for a web application again? So ideally speaking, if you are dealing with a normal new applications, anything that you're working out with a brand new one, web applications are perfectly a best choice. And websites are the cases where you really want to go wherein you have integration with any other third party or any other application which are not, any other websites which are not part of .NET, and like ASP applications or JSP applications that you want to live together, in those cases you can actually go for websites, and that could be a very rare scenario. In those cases you can go for the websites. Okay, otherwise web applications are the best choice to go with. And web services, we know, we're going to see the web services in subsequent sessions, and when we have a task on our hand to create a web service, we're going to walk through that web service as well. So ASP.NET you can use to create all these three types of applications, and of course, the more to that, we can also do the Silverlight applications and also integrate that with the Expression Blend and other tools for rich UI design, other things. And it is first released in Jan 2002, that's a little prior to the .NET Framework 1.0 got released. So it has been a lot of underwork done to really reshape the earlier successor, that is ASP, the Active Server Pages, which is again very popular in certain time, and of course it has a lot of issues with in terms of reusing the code and also making the code more flexible to handle. If at all you are completely new to ASP, then I have a link here that can take me to the page where I can quickly demonstrate how the ASP looks like. This is one of the ASP source code. If you see, the source code is tightly integrated within the HTML tags. You can see this, the code that is written inside the tags is a VBScript code. And VBScript code, if you see the dim cars, it's creating a variable there and reading the values from the request that's coming in and things like that. So it's pretty much the source code is actually embedded inside the HTML tags. That's how the way the code is written in the legacy world, and it is still doable this way also. You can write the same code and run it on a browser, it's going to still work fine. And even if you are a Java programmer, then you know how you can embed the JavaScript inside an HTML and you can render it. So ideally speaking, the browsers really read the code in that's written in this HTML form. In other way, even in ASP.NET, although you have the rich IDE and the flexibility to do the way you want to do it, at the end, when the response is sent back to the browser, it is an HTML code. Okay, and this is how the ASP code looks like. It is tightly embedded inside the HTML, and output can be visualized on the right-hand panel. So this is how the ASP looks like. Okay. And what is the problem with the ASP? The biggest problem is, we'll see down the line, okay? And this is a little bit of history for ASP.NET, how it got evolved out of it. So the major problem is in the first line. This is in 1997, the research from the Microsoft side started to achieve a highly scalable, building a highly scalable applications, especially with separation of presentation and the content, the highlighted one. The separation of the presentation and the content, in other words, the example that we have seen here, yep. In this case, the biggest flaw here is the code and the presentation both are in the same file, which is going to be more complicated for large applications, especially we can visualize how complicated it's going to look like. So that's one of the main objective to get the ASP.NET into play. But when the research has started, there's no .NET
in picture. We know that .NET got released in 2002. So since 97, it started creating the ASP.NET using the Java as a code, and it got released, the fundamental idea got released, it's not released, but its fundamental concept got created using Java, and it's called as the XSP. And the persons or the developers behind that is Anders. Anders is a project manager, but Scott is a person who brought that idea in place and also had a prototype created using Java to have a model that can separate the presentation versus the code. And in ASP.NET, that's one of the major advantage to have the presentation as ASPX page and the code behind as a C# code. So that's the later advantages we had. And later in the implementation, it's when the .NET came into picture, it's still in the lab, but C# got in, is planned to replace most of the other languages. So to bring the advantage of the .NET platform, so it's rebuilt using the C#.NET, and right now the ASP.NET is completely built in C#.NET, as the name suggests. And that time the project is termed as the Project Cool. This is kind of some FYI information, but again, it's good to know, but again, yeah, fine. And in 2000, this got demonstrated to the public it's just demonstrated, but it's still in the beta version, remember, and it got demonstrated to the public as ASP Plus. And in May, in the end of the 2000, when the demonstration went successful and the .NET got branded, it renamed to ASP.NET. And 4 years from there, we have a couple of beta versions got released, and finally the ASP.NET 1.0 version got released in Jan 2002, which is little early to the .NET framework 1.0 got released. There are a couple of days little early ASP.NET got into the market. Otherwise, the .NET framework itself got released in 13th Feb 2002. And this is the person. Right now he is the Scott. Scott is the vice president of the product team for the ASP.NET applications, including the Silverlight, WPF, and everything. So he's one of the man behind the base concepts of the ASP.NET. And this is one of the very important link that I forgot to give you in the beginning, and probably it's not too late again. So this is a web platform installer. If you can get this, it will get you all those tools applicable for you to build any web-based projects, and this is completely free. And if you, I can share this link this is a tool that you can download. This is completely 2010 Express Edition. The advantage of this tool is it's going to check for all the packages or dependencies that you need, especially as shown here. You can get the Visual Web Developer 2010 Express Edition. It can download that and also pick and choose even the SQL Server 2008 R2 Express Edition, and also IIS Express for hosting. So you have all these three components and also many other third-party components that you can get and install it in your local, and it has a very intuitive IDE. I can show you that in a later time, but for now, this is for FYI. You can use or even you can search in the Google for a web platform installer. You will find this link and use this to install all these components in one single stretch. So it's going to install, configure, and also it can get a lot of other third-party tools. You can make use of it. And in ASP.NET we have two important base programming models. Of course, MVC is one of the latest one got introduced in the recent time in 3.5. Otherwise, the ASP.NET web forms were the original flavor which we have been seeing right now. And MVC, we know, again, this might be too early to get into there, but I can show you how can you create a new MVC projects here. Where is this? Okay, web application, and this is an MVC2. You can also get the MVC 3 projects. So MVC is completely a new thing, and of course it asked me to create a new test project. That's one new thing with MVC. Using MVC and web forms, both are two different programming models altogether. I can make this as a startup project, and how does this look like? And this is a very interesting one, and if at all you're pretty good with the or aware of the MVC pattern itself, it comes with the model view controller pattern, and the code that is written here is completely with the controller pattern. And there are very big differences between the web forms versus the MVC. The major difference is that the web forms are have a postbacks and round trips to the servers. For every postbacks, we have an event-driven model, whereas MVC is not at all an event-driven model. I hope this is running. Okay, so it doesn't have any views at this point, so that's why it's not giving me any code, which is fine. I'm sorry, I'm actually running the test project there. So that's one of the major advantages with the MVC, that you can actually have a test projects and test in a web-based applications. So that's one major advantage with MVC, whereas the web forms, you cannot actually have automated test cases for pages. Why? Because the way they are having is an event-driven model. You cannot have it. So this is how the MVC pages look like. And also the routing is again is completely new in MVC. You don't have a page name appear in the URL. You can also implement the same thing in ASP.NET as well using the same routing engine, but MVC comes with that way. Okay, by default for ASP.NET you have to implement it explicitly. A couple of things here. This is the controllers and the view. Inside a view you have the ASPX page, but there is no code behind, so that's one big difference there. Since I'm having the ASP2, it looks a little different, but ASP3 is a lot more different than what I have here, and it doesn't have a code behind. That's a big thing. That's why that's why I say it's not a event-driven model, and everything once you hit the page, it's going to get into the controller directly, and the controller is the one that's going to do the HTTP post in simple. Okay, so that's kind of a little bit a very rough overview of the MVC. That's my next plan, is to cover a lot about the MVC, and so ASP.NET and MVC I try to cover in the next sessions properly. And we have a couple of more information about the web forms, ASP.NET web forms, as we discussed, and a couple of interesting features with the ASP.NET web forms. So in general, ASP.NET web forms provides a server-side web programming framework that enables you to use server-side controls within the HTML markup. So that's one advantage with the ASP.NET web forms, which we have seen, as I'm mentioning, that's an event-driven model. And this is a familiar control and event-based programming model. It brings that value, and controls encapsulate HTML, JavaScript, and CSS, and you have rich controls where you can actually leverage the HTML as well as JavaScript and all, as well as CSS, cascade, style sheet. JS and CSS, HTML are the internet standards, if you know. And the rich UI controls included the data grids, charts, AJAX, and everything you can make use of it, as we have seen in the web forms. We did make use of the grids, charts we haven't seen, but that rich UI controls are available in web forms. And browser differences are handled in your ASP web forms. That means if you build an application in ASP.NET, that can actually run on any browser. So the difference is you don't have to actually write a code to handle the browser differences. It can render the HTML based on the browser that is requesting the response. That's done at the IIS side itself. Okay, and the SharePoint builds on the web forms. That's one thing, if you're aware of what the SharePoint. SharePoint is a very huge thing. It's one of the most successful products, again, from Microsoft. That's a collaboration tools or development environment. You can build applications, share. You can do almost everything in SharePoint that with a very ease of code. You can actually have a documents repository created on the fly. You can share it with the team and also have applications created and hosted on the environment. It's a whole cluster of an array of benefits that you can get with the SharePoint, and it's a beast of its own. And it's again completely built with the web forms. And we see what's the, what are the things that's going to bring it on the table. And it feels comfortable for many traditional web developers, as we see that MVC is going to implement the legacy way of writing code. The way it is, you don't have a code behind, first of all. That's what ideally HTML does. HTML does have the code within, embedded within the HTML. And the way the traditional web works, that's how you can actually implement it, but still with the power of the .NET. And the pattern itself, a model view controller, the pattern itself is very rich and it enforces that. That's another one we'll see down the line. And total control of HTML markup and CSS and JS. In web forms, you don't have a total control on the HTML because generating the HTML out of your ASPX code is completely done at your ASP.NET runtime. Whereas in MVC, you can have a very good control on the view part, where in the view you can actually write a normal HTML code the way you want to write it, and also write anything that you want in the view, because view is a very lightweight and it's pretty much directly going to be in HTML, and you can also write the way you want it or include the scripts within it and write the way that traditionally programmers can write it. And that's the total control of the HTML way. So it's a So the traditional web developers really love this. They can get into this. But at the same time, it has MVC implementation, where the controller part is completely C# code, and then you're going to use the same .NET libraries and everything. So it's same. And supports unit testing and TDD and agile methodologies. That's a big plus for the MVC, which cannot be done with the web forms. You can have an automated test projects created. That's the first thing we see, that when I create a web MVC project, it prompts me for creating the test projects. So that's the big plus with MVC. You can create a test project for testing the UI functionality directly, which you can't do in web forms. And TDD is a test-driven development approach, which can be done easily with MVC. And those are the parameters wherein you can pick and choose which one is the best fit for the project. Again, MVC is again not replacing the web forms. Web forms and MVC are still there, going to be there, and both are different programming models, and one is good for versus other in based on the context in which it's been used. And encourages strong design patterns and implementations, which we have been telling. This MVC is a model view controller pattern. In simple terms, you have a model which is your data, the underlying data source. It could be any data source, of course, in general. In our case, if it's a SQL Server data, if I employ data that's coming out of the database, in our case, it represents the model. And the view is the plain UI that's going to be shown to the user, the end user. The end user is completely going to see only the view in general. And the controller is the one which is going to be handling any user requests, and is going to be intermediate between the model and the view. Probably it's not a good approach to tell oral, but probably I could show you with the proper examples and diagrams. So in which case it's going to be more easy to digest. In single line, if you say MVC is going to meet the separation of concern principles, wherein the model, view, and controller are completely independent to each other, the model doesn't know where the data is coming from, there is no postback going to happen. It's going to, once the user submits something, it's going to directly go into the controller hand, and there is no client-side postbacks and things like that, you know. And encourages strong design patterns and implementation, so that's what we have seen, an extremely flexible and extensible, and that's one major thing. So you can actually have multiple controllers, and the routing engine, you can tweak it to map to the respective controllers. Pretty intuitive and flexible. And navigation is one other thing. Routing, the MVC3 has a Razor routing engine, which is again much better than the traditional ASP.NET routing engine. Traditional ASP.NET web form routing engine is pretty much goes with the page name and its location on your in your system, in your project, or physically where the page is located. So you have to give the ASPX page name followed by its the query string and other things as part of the request. In MVC, it isn't like that. So you don't need to know where the file the view is physically at. You can actually tamper that using your routing configuration and route it to the respective place where you want to do it. So it's a pretty interesting concept with routing. And so we're going to see the request processing architecture, how the ASP.NET request processing really works. So this is the most interesting part. And I did really spend a lot of time in bringing this the best way I can and the detailed way as I can. So in this case, we all know there is a client, and the client posts a request to the server, and the server is going to process the request and send you back. So this is a basic thing that happens in a client-server model or in the web. Okay, there's more details here. What is a client and what is a server? What differentiate your client versus the server in terms of the web applications? In the client, as you see, a client with a machine. In client, in web terms, is the browser. So browser itself is an application that runs on the client machine that can manage the request and response that is that can be sent and received to the server. So it can talk to the other part of the server, and we don't know where the server is. That's the biggest part. And in client-server model, we know where the server is, but in internet, it's open to the network of networks, and we don't know where the server is, and there's a lot of things go behind the scene, and we try to see how this request is handled. And at the server side, what we have is, again, another machine that runs a software called an IIS, which becomes a web server. So in both the machines, what really makes a difference is when someone asks what is a client and what is a server, what makes the difference here is the software that's running on the given machine. I can have a same hardware configuration machine with me, but can I call it as a server or can I call it as a client? So what you can, what makes the difference is the software that is running in the machine. If I'm having a Windows Server 2003 on my machine, my hardware can be used as a server. I can configure any other applications. I host it and deliver the services like a server. If I'm having Windows XP or something or Vista, and I have only the client machine with I don't have an IIS configured, and I'm using only the client browsers, like any of these browsers, like Chrome or Firefox, IE and others, and I'm using it, so it's a client. So although you have the same hardware both the sides, if you're not having the right software, so your machine is a client. Okay, in general, what we are doing in the IE, the internet, is the client is a browser application, which is an IE or Chrome, whereas a server here is the IIS. So that makes a big difference here. So I can actually run both on the same machine, in other words, which we are doing so far actually. In my machine, I have a Windows 7, I have a configured IIS, and also I have the client browser in my machine. So I'm making my machine to behave both as a client and the server. So that's a typical scenario in the development world. So that's a little bit of overview of the client server and how the request response happens at the very high level. And what makes it different, what makes it more important with respect to the ASP.NET kind of applications hosted? Of course, the web applications are not just ASP.NET. There are a wide variety of technologies available outside, like a PHP, you have a JSP, and many more actually. So different web-based applications work in a different way, and they have their own servers like Apache or the WebSphere for IBM and so on. So in our topic of interest is with Microsoft, and Microsoft's web server is IIS. So to understand how the requests and responses are handled, it's always going to be IIS. So how IIS is all about, what IIS do, and things like that. So this slide talks about something about the IIS as an overview. So earlier it used to be an Internet Information Server, and today we call it as Internet Information Services, because IIS has evolved over a period of time drastically, and is a web server application and a set of feature extension modules created by Microsoft for use with Microsoft Windows. And it is the most used web server after Apache. HTTP server. Apache again is from the ASF, which is Apache Software Foundation. Is actually open community. It's a decentralized community of developers and non-profit corporation, and it is having the share of 60% of the market. In general, if you say the market share of Apache versus IIS, 60% is a very huge share that Apache is having right now. And the next biggest is the IIS in the market, in the web servers, which is sharing 19%, and followed by the remaining. And surprisingly, you don't see the WebSphere in this chart. WebSphere is from IBM, has a very, very small share in the market. Looks like it's less than 1%. That's why it's not even showed up in this chart. This is the statistics from the 2011. And what we have here is the IIS version history. So it started from 1.0 with Windows NT to 3.5, and today we have IIS 7.5, which is very robust web server. And what we're going to see down the line there is a lot of major changes went through the IIS way the requests are processed. So to keep in limit to our scope, we're going to walk through the differences with the IIS 6 and 7. IIS 6 and 7, there isn't much major change, but if you compare to IIS 5.1 or 5.0 to 6, there has been a major change the way the architecture looks like. So anyway, so we don't want to go to the older ones and really diagnose how they used to work, but we are more interested in how the current world really works and what are the benefits that we can gain from the current architecture. And before we step into the more details of IIS side, so some of the basic things here, the worker process. So we know that there is a worker process that's been running even in our local. If I run this project, for example, so and open my task manager, so what is that process that is running in my IDE? So here the process is the web dev web server 40.exe. So this is the 4.0 frameworks, the local web development server. This is a web server for development edition. This is by default available, and you can also actually configure your application to run with IIS Express if you install it the way I showed you in the first slide. You can download the IIS Express, which is almost same to as running the application on the IIS 7.0 or 7.5. Okay, and in this case, we're actually so far we have been running in the development environment, development server. And if you take a look at this, so this is the instance that is running. This is called ASP.NET development server that runs in your local. Okay, although I have IIS, I did not use that to configure, but although you can do it. Okay, so what's happened, so what we have seen here is a different exe that is not at all matching to what I have here. So this is a little different because when we make use of the IIS, then things will be different in the runtime. So the worker process exes or the ASP.NET WP exe when you have an IIS 5 or previous versions, that's the worker process. And the W3WP is the worker process that you will see when you deal with IIS 6 or later. Okay, and worker process is the main process that actually hosts your application and runs or handles your request and response cycles. And we'll see in detail how that happens. Okay, we'll have a deep dive into how IIS really works and how it handles the requests. And yes, so those are the worker process. So this process is responsible to manage all the requests and response that are coming from client system. All the ASP.NET functionality runs under the scope of worker process. So that's being said, that's the main process we need to know. And it runs under the default predefined user account. ASP.NET is a predefined user account under which that process runs in IIS 5, whereas in the recent ones, it runs under the network service account in IIS 6 and 7.5. And the next important umbrella is the application pool. The application pool is the container of worker processes where it can contain at least one worker process, and it can have many as well. So the application pools is used to separate sets of IIS worker processes that share the same configuration. So you can actually use the application pool to have a configuration of your application and within which you can actually have multiple worker processes again. And application pools enables better security, reliability, and availability for any web applications. And how it looks like? It looks like this in general. So at the process level, if you look at IIS, you can have multiple application pools within it, and within each of the application pools you can actually assign a given application to it, which will run under the given application pool. In memory terms, it's kind of an app domain that you're going to specify for each application pool. And you can also have multiple worker processors, and each of the worker processors are hosting a different web application. Here in this case, W3WP is a worker process inside an application pool, and it's hosting a web app 1 in this case, and a second web application pool is actually hosting a web app 2, and the third one here is hosting a two different worker processes within the same application pool, and both of these are hosting two different applications. This is very much possible. And also there is another deviation to it, wherein you can have the same application hosted on the same application pool with the multiple worker processes. That you can do, and we'll see what that means in the later slides. Okay, and here comes the drink. Okay, so this drink is again, there is a reason why this drink is sitting here. It's completely not for fun, and the reason being with the IIS and how the IIS is related to this. So when we talk about IIS 6 and compare to its predecessors, the IIS previous versions were hit with a number of vulnerabilities. Vulnerabilities refers to the concept of having a security loopholes. In other words, that's one of the area where people concentrate on how to hack and how to defend their websites, and that's one of the major hot topic we all know. And so the IIS older versions had a major setback with a lot of vulnerabilities, and especially it became more into the news with the people with the one of the worst WOM attack called the Code Red. The Code Red WOM got attacked in sometime in 2001, and it brought down all the IIS all the web applications that were hosted on the IIS throughout the world. Nearly, it's worked for about 13 days. It started hitting and spreading across the world. It even brought down the White House applications down, and it was a big setback in 2001. If you refer to the history, that's the one of the biggest attack happened on IIS, and that took almost 2 weeks or 3 weeks, almost a whole month to find and investigate, and finally they found that there is a new worm that entered, that's actually injected by the Chinese. They hacked the applications on the IIS web, hosted on the IIS web servers, especially the 5.0 and legacy IIS web servers, and they smartly could able to do it. And finally, one of the a security firm, which is EY Digital Security Employees, they investigated and they found that this is a code worm, and they able to finally stop that worm spreading across and able to restore it back. And they named this code red apparently because they were actually drinking this Mountain Dew code red drink by the time. And that's why, that's how this image has a relation to IIS. Okay, so that's an FYI's, a code red worm hit on IIS is one of the turn back in the history of IIS version. And IIS 6 got fixed all those vulnerabilities and become more robust in the way the architecture is designed to handle any of the security threats down the line. And today we have 7.5, which is much more robust in handling the vulnerabilities. And here comes the IIS request processing architecture. So again, IIS can run in two modes. One is the legacy mode, which is the IIS 5.0 isolation mode, which works the same way the IIS 5.0 works. And the current one is the worker process isolation mode, which we're going to see today. The worker process isolation mode is the default mode that in which it's going to work. If at all you want to switch back to the IIS 5.0 version isolation mode, then you have to manually configure it to do it. You might need to do it for the reason being, if you're designed to run your designed to code your application to target the legacy architecture, then you have to manually switch it over. In 7.5 also you have the backward compatibility where you can host, for example, ASP applications. If you're having an ASP web application, you still need to go back with the legacy way how the request response is handled, in which case you need to switch over to the 5.0 isolation mode. Ideally, for latest version applications, you don't have to do that. If it is completely web-based, especially the .NET based web application, you don't have to do that. But in 7.5 and 7.4, you have rich enhancements again done, refactoring a lot of things, which pretty much handles any type of resource request that can come in, not only the .NET, but also any other HTMLs or a JSP or any other resource files you request. They can leverage the ASP.NET modular functionalities for authentication, authorization, logging, the role-based and everything. So all those functionalities can be leveraged to any other source files or any other resource files. So today we're going to concentrate on the IIS 6.0, which is pretty much close to IIS 7 architecture. And here the server-wise, what we see is basically two major distinctions with respect to the IIS 6.0. What makes a difference here is the usage of the kernel mode. Hope you already know what's a kernel mode. Kernel mode is the place where the operating system code really runs. So when the operating system code really runs, means it's actually directly interfacing with the hardware components. In this case, the HTTP sys is the hardware device driver, which is stands for the HTTP protocol stack. Kernel mode device driver is part of the networking subsystem of the Windows operating system. And IIS, whenever you host an application on IIS, it's going to register that application with the with the HTTP sys. So it's a direct hardware way when the request comes in, it actually directly hits the hardware and it manages the HTTP request at the server side hardware itself. So that's one level down it went through. In 5.0, this is completely different scenario. There is no kernel mode operation. So everything is in the user mode operation, wherein it has to bypass any threat, any request that comes in will have to pass through the machine and then come in, wherein they can have a loopholes wherein you can do some harm to the kernel mode itself. You can inject a worm into your hardware and you can destroy anything. So to add an additional level of security and also processing speed, the kernel mode is added in the 6.0, which is again a very strong feature, and there's a big change in the architecture, the ASP.NET architecture. And what next is the user mode. The user applications run on the user mode, which is pretty much all your applications that you see normally, what we can run, including the presentation PPT or a word processor or, you know, my Visual Studio, everything is running under the user mode, which is of course governed by the operating system. And we don't directly interact with the, any of the hardware we have on the system. And here comes the client. So what happens when the client send a request to the server? And that's the request. And the request of a URL. So in this case, I have myserver.com, my application, and my page. That's how the usual request comes in for ASPX pages. And how it is handled from the client to the server. So next immediate thing comes the internet, of course, which is a big black box for us. How things are routed through various servers on the internet, which is the network of networks, and then finally sees the destination point where this application is hosted. In general, in simple terms, if you see the when you register a domain name with a domain naming services, they provide the name and the server where it is hosted in general. So the request normally gets through the domain DNS and gets the IP address of the machine, and then the request is routed to the server. So in this case, we don't want to get into too details of how the request is routed back all the way back to the server where it is hosting. So that's how it is done. You get the domain name, DNS services, and get the IP address of the machine, and then route it to the machine. So in this case, it's all passed it, and the request came into the server, which is our Windows Server 2003 hosting an IIS 6.0. So the request comes into the HTTP sys, as we know, because the HTTP sys is actually the front gate for your machine, which is directly at the running at the kernel mode, and it is interfacing the networking device, which is your network interface card or firewalls and other things. And immediately after the request is received, a HTTP sys has a couple of internal modules. There are a couple of several other modules within the HTTP sys that can that are working around, but most importantly, I have two showing up here. One is the kernel mode cache. So the kernel mode cache is going to cache any of the pages that it already served in the past. In this case, since this is the first request that's coming in, it checks in the kernel mode cache and it don't see that this request has been ever served. So this will pass the next step. It's going to get into the kernel mode request queue, whereas HTTP sys also maintains the request queuing mechanism. Earlier it was completely at the IIS side. There is no request queuing mechanism done at the kernel mode. So IIS, the HTTP sys does have a kernel mode request queuing. And what it does is it's going to route the request to the appropriate respective applications within your IIS. So in this case, this is the first time the request is coming in, and it sees it's not in the cache, okay, then it's going to get to the request queuing, and the request queuing see that it's not yet queued so far, because this request is the first request that's coming in. And at this point, we need to set our understanding that the application is built and it's hosted on the IIS. We have configured the application pool, and the application pool has mapped to the respective application website or the virtual directory, which is mapping to the respective application. Again, hosting an application is the last thing that we're going to do throughout our application. So we're going to see that part in the next session. Okay. So at this point, consider the application is hosted on the IIS. Okay. And the request queuing is going to check if the request is already queued. It sees no, it's not, and that's going to send a request to the WAS, which stands for the www service, the World Wide Web Service. In other words, the WAS. Again, so don't mistake the www that you are hitting on the URL. That is a different thing, and this is a different thing. Okay, so don't try to mix up both. So this is the WAS is a Windows Process Activation Service, or simply Windows Activation Service that's running inside a server. Okay, this has nothing to do with the www that you are hitting in the URL. Okay, and in general, the server side, it's named as WWS. The file name is w3svc.dll. Okay, so that's the DLL that's going to be hosted. This will be managing the application pool on the IIS, and once it is, it's going to check if the application pool is already created. In this case, it's not created, so it's going to create the application pool within that. Within that, it's going to create the W3WP, which is your worker process. W3WP, yep, this is the exe that's responsible to handle your process. In our development environment, we did see the web dev web server 40.exe. That's the server. In the server side, it's going to be W3WP that's going to be running. Okay, so that's the worker process created for your application, and once it is created, it's going to send back the signal saying the kernel mode is going to tell that yes, the worker process is now active, you can make use of it. So immediately the kernel mode request queuing is going to create a queue for that process. So now it identifies the application. In this case, the server is the first thing that's identified and followed by the application. So based on the application, which application pool is configured, that application pool is going to be created, and the worker process is going to start loading the application side. And during this process, there's a lot of things that happens behind the scene, which is going to be the next topic for us. What happens here is the application lifecycle is going to kick off, and we'll see what happens inside an application lifecycle, and that's where you will start looking at the code side. Okay, so that's the next step. And all that application lifecycle thing happens, the request enters into the application lifecycle and process the whole stuff and gets the response out, which is going to be your HTML that the browser can understand, and that's sent back to the request queuing. And what kernel mode is going to do that is going to, now it knows that for this application, this is the request queue it's created, and now the queue is available for the subsequent queues. So when the next request comes in, it will not go back to WAS and ask it to activate the process. It's going to straight away knows that the queue is already there, and it's going to start dumping the request to the queue. And now the response is back. The response is now is going to pass through the HTTP sys, and within the kernel mode cache, it's going to cache it, kernel mode, and send the response back to the internet. And the same routing will happen back to the client where the request is routed, and that's how the response is served to the end user. And so subsequent requests again will not pass through the WAS, as I said. If now at the first stage, subsequent request for the same page is going to see if it is in the cache. If it is there, then it's going to serve it from there itself. So the subsequent request is going to be very, very fast. So the response time is going to be much faster with the new architectural model. And also, it's not going to just do the steps that we have seen. The HTTP sys does a lot of other things with respect to the vulnerabilities. It's going to check the request, the authenticity of the request that's coming in, and make sure the request is not a harmful request. And if at all it's an authenticity is not met, it's going to reject the request at the server before it's entering into the system itself. So that's the major security stuff it's going to handle at that point, and also it caches the responses that are coming out so that the load at the IIS can be handled at the machine itself. So it has a very big advantage in the new IIS version. And subsequently, if your request comes for the new application, the same thing will happen. It's going to reactivate the respective worker process for the new application, and create the worker process for that and put the queue there and process the request back. So within IIS, you can have multiple application pools created. And one more key important thing about IIS application pool is that application pool, you can imagine that as a one process area within which it can handle multiple other worker processes. So what it means is the memory or the application level caching, whatever you want to save in your application or the application cache, which we're going to see again. So session state or application state or a couple of things, concepts, key concepts that we're going to see. And then we'll jump into the source code and then walk through each and every line of code, and probably that time we can understand it much better. Okay? And yes, so the worker process is done and the request is queued back. Now what we did not see here is what happens inside the application pool. Okay, that's our next immediate thing. So now the request here, again, the request comes in from the client, passes through the, of course, the web and the IIS or any other web servers. It comes into the ASP.NET, which is the runtime again for the ASP.NET applications. And what happens here is a very big thing, a very big sequence of steps. The first thing here is the ASP.NET ISCP. Here the mappings for each of the resources is handled at the ASP.NET. In the IIS side application level, you're going to map to the respective DLL for the type of resource that's coming in. So the mapping is done at the IIS side to load the respective DLLs. In this case, if the ASPX page is coming in, the ASPX will have the resource mapping to the respective DLL that need to be loaded to process it. So the key DLL here is the ASP.NET ISAPI DLL. And for the it's a resource mapping. It's done at the IIS side. It's going to load this DLL and manage the runtime. And what it's going to do immediately is it will create the HTTP runtime. And that's when it gets into the HTTP runtime. And if at all you're actually, there's another key note there. Since these ASP.NET specific DLLs are separate from the IIS installation, so there is one key thing that we need to remember, that when the sequence of steps you follow to install the IIS and the .NET framework. Ideally, in your local development environment, a case like you have already installed the IIS in your machine, and then you install the ASP.NET or the Visual Studio or .NET framework, what happens is IIS will not know that the ASP.NET ISAP DLL is available or ASP.NET specific runtime DLLs are available. So you need to actually explicitly tell the IIS that these DLLs are available. So that you can do by running the ASP.NET rig IIS command in the command prompt. So that's a tool available to register your ASP.NET with the IIS. So that's a key thing to know. And the next step comes in here is the HTTP runtime. With the help of the HTTP application factory, creates the HTTP application. So at this point, the runtime is going to kick into active, and it's going to create the HTTP application. Where is this HTTP application is all about? And we see at the bottom, we see that these are the HTTP applications that are created for each of the requests that are coming in. And we have a pool of HTTP application request objects that are created here. and that roots back to our first code file that we can see here, which is our global.asax, and its code behind, it's inheriting from the HTTP application. So that's the first thing that get hits at this point. If we go back to our application, if I expand this, we'll see this global.asax. In the recent versions, the global.asax is added by default. That comes as part of the template when you create the ASP.NET project. In the older versions, like to the Visual Studio 2005 or .NET Framework 3.5 and other things, so it's not going to add up by default. So you need to explicitly add it and play with that. And in this case, so if you see, this is the HTTP application that we're talking about. So this is the first thing that's going to be HTTP runtime is going to look create. In our case, we have the, since we implement the global, it's going to load this for your application. And if you don't have this for your application, it's optional. Again, it doesn't harm you. If you don't have this file, there's no harm. So it's going to consider that the default HTTP application, and it's going to load it. And the advantage of having this here is it's going to have the lot of events available which you can actually handle and make handle things at the application level. And one other thing I have done here is the application error. So the anything happens in the application scope, what I'm trying to do here is handle that exception and redirect the error to the global error page in this case. That's what I'm trying to do here. So if I add a breakpoint here, because this will give me a handle at the application level, so I can do anything at the application level, including me handling my application cache and also even my session start. So again, these events, couple of events will be fired only once. Like for example, the application start event, this will be fired only when the application is getting loaded. That means at this point where the HTTP runtime will happen, when the first HTTP application is created, at that time that's going to be fired, and resolve time is not going to fire. Again, his application end is going to visited only when you shut down the application. Another important event here is the session start. So in this case, so this is the event that's going to be fired for every session that's going to be created. Again, what is a session again? So a session is specific to a user. So if in this case I am the only one user that I'm running this application. So ideally speaking, if at all there are multiple users, for in this case the session start got fired, and session is going to be, once the session is created, since we have the login page, the session start is triggered. That's part of the authentication. Once the authentication is done, the session is, once the session is created in the memory, it's not going to be visiting again. So that's again specific to the session creation. When a new user logs into the application, this will be fired for every user logs in. So that's the key difference between the application start and the session start. Okay, and also whenever the user logs off, then the session end will also get fired. So again, for that you need to actually write a explicit code to abort this session. We will see the session application cache, session cache, and other means of state management in the following sessions. But for now, I'm completely limiting this for the application lifecycle. Okay, so that's what happens with the HTTP application. We see that's what will get hit first when the first request comes in, and HTTP runtime is going to handle that. And the third step will be the HTTP runtime.processRequest. And HTTP runtime process request will pass the HTTP context, will create the HTTP context at this point. And HTTP context is the main thing going forward. So it will, as you see, HTTP context can be visualized this way as well. You can actually, from the code, you can access the HTTP context at this point using the HTTP context.current and read the request and response from the HTTP context itself. So the request that's coming in is part of the HTTP request, and the response that you're going to send out is part of the HTTP response. To quickly see that, I will get into the default.aspx page, and yeah, in this case we can see the same thing. HTTP application is the one you can actually use this. In this case I wanted to see the HTTP context. HT is equal to HTTP context.current. So the current will represent the current HTTP context, and within this I can get the HTTP request. HR is equal to HR.HTTP. Sorry, HT dot, sorry, HT dot request. And similarly, I can make use of this response, and the response object I can read through this. Okay, so what all I have from the HT? HT dot, if I take a close look at the list of items available, we can see everything from the HTTP context. As we see, this is the main object that is created, encapsulating the request that's coming in along with the information of the application. Okay, so what we'll see, we can actually put a breakpoint here and run this code. And login. I can make use of the my quick view here, quick watch, and walk through the content that's encapsulated within the HTTP context at this point. And I see there is no error with the page and the caching object I have, the application. Application specific contains anything, application cache in other words. If you, this is an application cache that's going to take care of, you add any data to the application cache, then you can access it using the application. And in our case, request and response are the main two objects. In this case, if you see the request is coming in for the default.aspx because we are inside the default load. And all that information that's that you might want to know, and including the query string or the view state and everything else. And the response is the place that is going to send back the response to, including from where this request is routed or routed, and which browser the client is having, and all of that information you can actually gain from the, or actually you can get the browser information from the request header itself. And there is something called HTTP headers that you can also watch through. It's a little difficult to actually diagnose using this route. There is a much easy way to do that in .NET. The easy way to look up the content that is coming in and going out, the easiest way is the trace. I can actually enable trace dot is in, sorry, is enable is equal to true. So I can do this even from the configuration side as well. I can add that trace inside my web.config and manage that, but in the code also I can do this. So what will this give me? So this is a very, very informative tip in the real world. If you really want to make you diagnose what is actually a request that's coming in, this is the easiest way to actually look at the request. So we are in the defaulted ASPX, and what I see below my page is a hell lot of information about the request that's coming in, including the trace information of my events that have been handled, the way the events are loaded and how much time each of the events took. You can profile your response time as well, and also the control tree, how much time it took to generate this control tree, and most importantly the session state, application state, and also the cookies that are being visited. In this case, I see the authentication cookie I can see, which is of course an encrypted one, I can't do anything with that. And ASP.NET session ID also I can see. This is the session ID that's created in the ASP.NET. This is part of the session start event. Once the session ID is created, it's not going to come back and do the session start event. Okay, so all this information you can actually see with ease of one single line of code, and the server variables are also available here, which you can all your HTTP headers that I've been talking about, all that I can see here. This will also have the kind of browser information that I'm trying to use, and the agent, the user agent here is Mozilla, and things like that. So based on the browser, also you can tweak your code to respond back the way the browser handles the information, and also see the user logger information here. The auth user is my name, and of course the type is a forms authentication type, and the physical path and everything else. So needless to explain. So this information is pretty much available once I turn this on. Okay, so you can make this as a configurable option and make it available in your application, so that down the line, if at all in a production environment, you want to see what is a request coming in, and you can turn it on and turn it off in any time. Okay, and also you can also log that information to a log file. So that's another piece of information. So that at this point, we see the HTTP context, how the request and response objects looks like, and how to access them, excuse me. And the next one comes in here, the HTTP application will pass the HTTP context that we have seen right now. It will pass through a tunnel called the HTTP pipeline. The pipeline is a very crucial thing in the whole modular approach of the IIS processing. The pipeline is a very interesting one, we'll see. It has a series of HTTP modules, and at the end of the tunnel, the request will pass through all these modules, and finally at the end of the tunnel it's going to be handed over to the HTTP handler. And the HTTP modules and HTTP handlers are very, very important topics, and the HTTP modules are, both of these are configured in the web.config. In the new versions, it's all configured the machine level web.config. It's no more in the machine.config FII, and this is how the pipeline looks like visually. If you take a look at it closely, the pipeline has a request coming in, it has a series of HTTP modules, and we'll see what are those modules in the next slide. And at the end of the processing, it passes through the HTTP handler. In this case, the handler is going to be specific to the resource that's coming in. We'll also see what are these handlers look like. And at the end of the tunnel, they will go into the page lifecycle. So this is where your page will have the control, and the page lifecycle will begin. And what is a page lifecycle? We'll also see. Okay, and once the page lifecycle is done, the response is rendered back, okay, and it goes back again. It passes through the same HTTP modules and reaches back to the IIS processing cycle. And in this case, HTTP modules will have the handle to your requests and responses both in and out. Okay, so you can actually implement your own custom HTTP modules and add it to your application that can listen to your each and every request that's coming into your application before they get handled, in other words. So before even they get handled by the normal HTTP handlers and reach the page lifecycle, we'll see what's the page lifecycle. It's starting from your page load, page init, pre-init. Before the handle goes to your application, you can actually handle the request at the HTTP module level. Why I'm stressing here is, if at all you want to implement a security module, right? The way we did the security module is the completely ASP.NET security implementation that we did. Ideally, there will be cases wherein you would like to implement a HTTP module to handle your security scenarios, in which case you will write a HTTP module. And what that happens is, before the request goes into your application, the request is handled at the HTTP module itself, and if there is any kind of customization or custom role-based access that you want to define, you can actually define it at that level. And then you can pass the information back or reject the information there itself. You can have that flexibility there. So this is a complete modular one. So this is how the HTTP modules and HTTP handlers configuration-wise it looks like, and the configuration, the application-specific configuration, in other words, will be available inside your Microsoft bin and the framework. Within this, we need to drill down to config. And we'll see the couple of machine.config file, and of course there are a couple of other config files here, out of which we are more interested in the web.config. So the configuration in the ASP.NET starting from 2.0 onwards, this mechanism is available, wherein this is hierarchical configuration. So this is the machine level first thing. This is the first step where the configuration is read and loaded into the memory, and what this configuration looks like. And always keep in mind, don't tamper these files, because these are a machine level file, and of course these are more like your web.config only. So it has a couple of sections, like even the app settings and other things. So the config file that we are having, in other words, is actually deriving from the configurations at the machine level, the web.config. In ASP.NET, our configuration is very lightweight, because I added a lot of other things, it grew drastically. Otherwise, the default configuration is very lightweight, unless you want to add many things, because all those default settings are moved to the machine level web.config. So when I add a web.config in my application, it's going to inherit from the machine level web.config, and also that that config file will inherit from the machine config file. So the hierarchy comes like the machine level config file will come first, and the machine level web.config comes next, and the application specific config file comes next. And again, within the application, we have also seen that we have a folder level web.config again. So this is the hierarchy. Okay, I don't want to check this out. Okay, so this is the hierarchy, the way the configuration is handled for the application. Okay, there are many things that can be handled in the machine level, so that the rest of the applications don't have to handle them. That's what's happening in this case. If I try to look for HTTP modules inside my machine.config, I don't see that. I see only the section that's added up, but I don't see the configuration for this HTTP modules. And similarly for HTTP handlers. So this is an empty one. So there's nothing implemented here at the machine level. So that's a big change again. Earlier, all this configuration used to be in the machine only. In 4.0, it's actually moved to the machine level web.config, wherein all the HTTP handlers are here inside my machine level web.config, but I don't see any of these HTTP handlers in the application specific one. If you see HTTP handler, I have only one because this is again added with the XSD, so there's nothing else. So this indicates that you can add your own HTTP modules, customize one, or else you want to overwrite any of the base configuration settings, then you can do that. So if you take a look at this ASP X page, so which is the type that's handling it? It's done by the page handler factory. So it's going to be the core one. So things like this, the response will be handled this way. The high level one is the ASP.NET IS API DLL, which is configured at the IIS level. So this is the main DLL that's going to be coming in first. And to look at that, that's going to be within the here. So this is the ASP.NET IIS API. So this is the main DLL that's going to be configured at the IIS level. And once the ASPX request or any .NET specific request comes in, this is the DLL that's going to load it up. What this DLL is going to do is it's going to look up into, once the application handle is reached, it's going to look up into the your machine specific web.config for that given resource. So okay, you can actually think about this way. If you take a look at the configuration here, this is the wrong one. We have a wide variety of resource files that are mapped to different things, including the SVC file, trace.xsd. The most familiar ones is the ASAX, which is your global.ascx, and other things. So it has the respective handlers available here. And once it's reached here, it's going to load the respective handler and then process it. And in certain cases, if you see the ACX, or even if you see the code pages as well, CS files, this indicates that if someone tried to request for a given file, then the ultimate handler, what is used here is the HTTP forbidden handler. What this forbidden handler is going to do is the reject the request at this point. So it's going to return the 401 or 403 error, HTTP error response header, which is going to say the not available or unauthorized access to those files. So this is again the handle that you already have. You can change it in your application, customize it to map any of the custom resources. For example, if you have a PDF file request coming in, and the PDF file, you have a process you have defined in your application. For a PDF file, when someone asks for a PDF file, you will write your customized HTTP handler. You can configure that here, and you can write your implementation to how to handle that request. You might do this way. You can actually go and hit a database, generate a PDF on the fly, and then return the response. You can implement that way, so that when users hit your URL on the top, they can actually hit the respective PDF as a request to your application. So you can do all of that using your HTTP handlers, and the modules come before that. Okay, as we see, the modules comes before the handlers because first they need to pass the modules and then hit the handler. Okay, handler is specific to the resource type, as we have seen. So each of the resource type, like in this case tar.cs, it has its own handler. Okay, and modules are generic for all the requests coming in. What type of default modules that are available here, like the output cache? Okay, yes, the output cache, the session state management, your authentication, Windows-based authentication, forms-based authentication, passport-based authentication, role manager, URL authorization, all these are fundamental things that are happening in our case, right? So when who is taking my page to a login page, it's done based on my forms authentication, because I'm using the forms authentication in my, and this is done at the HTTP modules. And this is what I'm also referring to. If at all you want to implement your own security authentication or authorization rules, then you can actually configure it at this point. And what it takes for you to implement, it's not so complicated actually. So what it takes you to do is, only thing is to write a library or a class that implements the IHTTP module in this case, and in the for HTTP handler, you just have to write and implement IHTTP handler. This is where again the interfaces comes into a very big rescue. Okay, and this is the request processing architecture for 7.0 and 7.5, and wherein I did not put much of an effort in this case because this is again a subset of the way the 6.0 really works, and in this case the difference is that 7.0 has completely a configuration driven. So there's a configuration file called application host config file which is going to be visited by the svchost.exe, which is again hosting the WAS, which is Windows Activation Service that we have seen. Otherwise the it passes through the same HTTP sys, and it runs in the kernel mode, and you have the user mode again within which it runs the WAS. It's going to again look up for the application host configuration file for to see the application where it's configured to, and then it's going to WWS service will come into play to request the application pool to create the app pool, in this case W3WP, and within which it's going to have worker process going to pass through all the HTTP modules. The same thing, the only thing is the differences are the few differences are here. It's a new modular design that allowed for a reduced attack surface again, so more security vulnerability implementation there, and introduced a hierarchical configuration system allowing for simpler site deployments. Again, this is for a site deployment, which is an application host.config is something new added up, and a new Windows Forms based management application. So it's new, and again Windows Forms based management application wherein you can configure the application from the IDE itself. It has a console that you can make use of it for managing the applications, and a new command line management options also available for IIS 7 and 7.5, wherein you can automate, you can write the command shell scripts to manage your deployment or hosting your applications. And for further reading, I have a link here which will take you to the learn.iis, and this has a further more information, introduction to the IIS 7 architecture, and it's a lot of informative information about the HTTP sys and WWW service and other things available in this site. You can always feel free to visit the learn.iis.net page, and also you can download the IIS from here, including the IIS Express one. We'll continue the page lifecycle. Okay, yeah, sorry about the delay. I was just trying to open the slide. Okay, so we got, this is the slide that's going to run through the page lifecycle. So what happens when the request comes in? So the first request, this is the request that's coming in to our system, and we already cover what all will happen once the first request comes in, the IIS process and all the HTTP context and the HTTP pipeline and all that stuff is done. At this point, we have entered into the page lifecycle. So what happens, the first place is the pre-init event fires within the page. When we talk about the page lifecycle, we are actually talking about the various events that occur during the page lifecycle. And in the code, I have a couple of events in the base page. I did actually override a couple of them, and that will actually show you the mappings from the slide that I'm showing here. So the pre-init occurs at the beginning of the page initialization, and you can use this for checking the is post back property and determine whether this is the first time the page is being processed. So the page has a is post back property that you can make use of to check if the page is being rendered for the first time. Ideally, when the page is loaded for the first time, it's going to be set to be false, and for the second time, it's going to be true. So vice versa probably. And create or recreate the dynamic controls. It's going to create the, you can use this for creating or recreating any dynamic controls that you're using on the page, and also set the master page dynamically and any other controls that you want to add up or manipulate at this stage. So at this stage, the controls are not yet created. So at this point, the controls, you can actually manage to create them. And immediately, next comes the initialization, which is init. The name itself is init. And if you look at the code, that's the on init is the page event that I'm overriding here, and I'm still calling the on init. So in simple, we can refer to that as an init. So in the init, what happens is the raised after all controls have been initialized, and any skin settings that you can apply for the website and have been applied, and the init event of individual controls occurs before the init event of the page. So this is again a bottom-up approach for these events. If you have a parent-child relationship, like within a page I have a 10 number of controls, then all the init events of the respective children will be fired fired first, and then the page will be fired next. So there is another chart that I can show you. I will show you at the end of this, which will describe which of the events are bottom-up and which of the events are top-down. So there's a clear distinction between these events, and of course we need to know about that. And use this event to read or initialize control properties. Okay, so that's self-explanatory. And this is the event that follows the init, which is init complete. And this is going to be raised at the end of the page initialization stage. So, and you can use this event to make changes to the view state. So at this point, the view state is what going to be loaded into the page. And view state is a temporary store wherein you can actually save any data which is going to be available between the page postmax. Okay, so that's the place, ideal place where you want to have the data. Since the request and response is stateless, this is the place where you want to store any information that you want to make use of it. Even the property values or the control values that are being saved will be saved into a special kind of a control state, which is similar to a view state, but there is a slight difference between the control state and the view state, which probably we'll see in the next session. And at this point, the view state will be read from the page request and then made available, and you can access the view state of the page. Okay, and the preload. So followed by is a preload. This is raised after the page loads view state for itself and all the controls. And after it, processes postmax data that is included with the request instance. So as it's explained, so all the view state of the respective controls will be loaded. That means the preload, you will have access to the content of the controls that has been created. And this is the time the load event comes in. At this point, the page object calls the onLoad method on the page object and then recursively does the same for each child. So this is an event which happens top-down, wherein the parent load is called and then followed by the child load events will be fired, which is a contradiction to the other event, which is init event, which is bottom-up. And until the page, all the controls are loaded. And the load event, the load event of the individual controls occurs after the load event of the page. This is the top-down approach. And use the onLoadEvent method to set properties in controls and to establish database connections. Of course, this is a very common event that you would like to make use of it. In our case, since we transferred the respective control from search page to the managed department page, so load is the right place where you want to read the content of the query string and all the session state and everything. So at this point, everything is available for you to access it. And the load complete comes immediately after that, which is raised at the end of the event handling stage. What happens between load and load complete is the respective controls event handlers will be taken care. So all the control respective controls, if for example you have the grid view selected event and other events that you have handle, all those events will be taken care of between the load and the load complete. And the load complete is the point which will trigger you saying that all the event handling is done. And this event You can use it for tasks that require that all other controls on the page be loaded. Okay? And followed by the pre-render. So it's raised after the page object has created all the controls that are required in the order to render the page. So this is the end, it's the beginning of the end stage of your page lifecycle, wherein the response is trying to go out from your control. So at this point, you still have a control wherein you can actually manipulate any of the controls output that is going out. So the page object raises the pre-render event on the page object, and then recursively does the same for each child control. So again, this event is a top-down event which happens for the parent first and followed by all the child controls. And use this event to make final changes to the contents of the page or its controls before the rendering stage begins. And this is a pre-render. And that there comes the pre-render complete, and this is going to get raised after each data bound control whose data source ID property is set calls its data bind method, in which case we did the bind call for a grid in our search click event, and this is when the pre-render complete is going to happen. And at this point, at that pre-render complete, you can actually do again a manipulations to the data elements that you want to do any kind of data element manipulations for, especially for the grids and other things. Oops. And the last one is the save state complete. So this is the place where the view state information is saved back to the response, and which is going to be rendered to the output cycle. So wherein the page is going to be completely rendered, and it's going to be raised after view state and control state have been saved for the page and for all controls. So there is a slight difference between a view state and a control state, ideally. So control state is refers to the area wherein the all the control text, whatever properties you are setting. So that property, the control value is actually going to sit into the control state, but not in the view state. And similarly, the data that is retrieved out and bound to the grid, so that kind of a data, if you want to save it in the view state, that's going to be going into the view state. So which in the key difference between both is that you can disable the view state for a given control or for the whole page, but you cannot disable the control state, because the control state is implicitly internally needed for persisting the page state between the postmax. And view state is optional. You can have it or not, and there are certain best practices that you need to follow, especially if, when you have data retrieved from the server which is large in size, and you really don't want to enable a view state for such responses, in which case the response size is going to be drastically high. And of course, if the response size is going to be high, then of course your processing time is also going to be high. And hence, you will try disable the view state for pages with high volume of data. Okay, so those are the special considerations you need to take care of with the view state and the control state. And once it saves state complete, the response will be encapsulated into your response and response object, and the HTML content is sent to the client. So that's the page lifecycle. So this is a very common thing that people will normally ask you to talk about, what is a ASP.NET page lifecycle. And so these are the couple of events in the code. If you take a look at this, how they do normally look like. So you have on load, you have on pre-render. These are the various event handlers which you can handle. So in our project, we did make use of the on init to create that controls dynamically or initialize those values here. So this is one of the typical example we made use of it. We will come back to this piece of code down the line. Okay, And that's about the page lifecycle we did talk about. So I have a different kind of presentation on the same in this slide, which I really made use of in a different way. So this is the page slide which talks about the various page lifecycle events, wherein you can see the bottom up. So which one are the events that will fire? If you take a look, close look at this chart, this is the page methods. In other words, these are the this includes the methods that can be called, and the page events. We are more interested in the page events here. So sorry. Okay, so the control method, the control methods and events are here within the control, the events on the controls, and this is the page level events that are we see. So if you see the init is available both for the control as well as for the page. So which one comes first? The init for the controls will come triggered first, and then the page events. Similarly, if you take a look at the pre-init is available only for the page, not for the control. So init is something that is a bottom up event. So this will fire for all the controls in the page and then to the page. Okay, and init complete is again applicable only for the page, not for the controls. And load view state is something that's again at the control side, which is again a bottom up. So if you within the controls, if you have any containers and like a panel, and within which you have multiple other controls, then the load view state will fire from the bottom up again. So this is again a bottom up event, and load view state is not available for the page. Okay, it's for the control only. And similarly, the load, if you take a look at this, is an opposite example. So load will get fired for the page, whereas the load for the controls will get fired next. So this is a top-down way of handling the events. Okay, so there's a difference in couple of events that can fire from bottom-up and top-down. Okay, this is important to identify this difference because people do normally ask, and also it's important when you really do some coding at that point. You need to know which one event will get fired first and the next. And some of the other basic terminologies that you might see is the web garden and web farming. And this slide talks about web garden. And what is a web garden? We did already see a web garden example, and we'll just see some theory part of it now. Not too long, but very short. This is an ability to have multiple worker processors hosted within an application pool. And we did see what is an application pool when we talked about the IIS. So the application pool is the area pool area where your application will be hosted, and of course by default it will have one worker processor if you don't specify it explicitly. So there is an option in the IIS where you can specify how many worker processes you can host on how many instances of your application can be created within your application pool. In other words, the number of worker processes you can configure. If it is more than one worker process, then it becomes a web garden. So ideally, what web gardens talks about is having two different worker processes hosting the same application. As we see, this is under the application pool, we have a worker process 1 and a worker process 2, which is nothing but your W3WP exe. So that's the same exe executable for worker process. And this is hosting web app 1 and web app 2. So it's the same web application hosted on two different worker processes and hosted on a single application pool. So this scenario is termed as a web garden. In other words, a garden is a if you visualize in your real life, it's a garden that's part of your home itself. So it's one home. So whatever you have within your home is your garden or back. So in this case, what we are referring to is the topology-wise. If you take a look at this, so it's talk about a single server. So within the same web server, you can have the application pool. Within the application pool, you have the multiple worker process hosted. So in other words, you're actually hosting the application in two different instances. What will this give you is ability to handle more requests, and at the same time, in other words, it gives you a better throughput performance on the response time. Response time can be reduced, so the latency can be much shorter for a web garden scenario. So when will you go for a web garden scenario? Ideally, you don't need to have this scenario. So most of the applications, if the number of users, concurrent users especially, that's very important. When if the number of concurrent users are more to your application, then the scenarios, and also it's not too drastically high. So for example, in normal business scenarios or normal topology-wise or normal web applications, if one web application instance can handle up to 200 to 250 concurrent users, it purely depends upon how the application is designed and what are the activities the web application is going to perform. So it's not a thumb rule that one web instance can handle 250 concurrent users. It's never it's not going to be a concurrent thumb rule. You can never say that, because it all depends upon what kind of operations your application is doing. So saying that, so on an average, if you consider that this application is plain as simple as our HR project application, then definitely it can handle 500 concurrent users in one single instance. At the same time, so if you're expecting to have a more load, then definitely you can go with the web garden. So like a load is definitely not going to be like thousands or millions, but in hundreds, okay, if you're talking about like 1,000 users, okay, you can tweak it to have multiple worker process and check if that really works for you. And how can you do that? This is where how the configuration looks like in IIS 6 within the app pool settings. So this is the state, the app pool settings. Within this, you have something called web garden settings, wherein you have maximum number of worker processes. By default, this is going to be one, and you can set it to any number based on your need. And if it is more than one, then that can be set to have a web garden. And similarly for IIS 7, it's the same thing. You can walk through from application pool, advanced settings, and this is within the IIS configuration. And wherein you have a maximum worker process, you can set it to 2, which means it's going to be a web garden. So in the description, it also says max process, max number of worker process permitted to serve the service request for the application pool. If this number is greater than 1, then the application pool is a web garden. So the description within the configuration say it's going to talk about that. Okay, so hope you're clear with this. It's a very simple thing to understand. And the next bigger picture is a web form. So it's just like I just got some form pictures there, but has nothing relevant to web form. So the web form is the next higher version to your web garden. So web garden is both are, of course, purpose-wise, both are for the same purpose, for higher performance, higher scalability, availability, and centralization and things like that. Okay, in web garden, since you're hosting on two different worker process, session state management becomes a critical thing, because if you're having a session maintained within the same server, then that is fine, because both these worker processes are hosted on the same server, so the server memory is still accessible within the same server. So if you're going with the in-proxy session state, it is completely fine with web garden. But when it comes to web farm, that's going to be a problem, because web farm, if you take a look at the web topology, it talks about having multiple instances of this application on different web server. In this case, it's a web server 1 and web server 2. So farm is more than just your home, so it expands beyond your home. So So this is the reason why the in-proc session state won't work good, because in-proc session state always refers to the current server, and within this topology what happens is if the user is requesting for a page, and the load balancer is going to distribute that load to the respective available server at that given point of time. Say for example, the first instance, the load balancer decides that okay, the server 1 is available to handle your request, so it will send the request here, and at this point it's going to create, say this is the first time you're logging into the system and you create a session, a user session in this web server. If you're using an in-proc session state, then the session is going to be created on this box. So this box will not have that. Okay. So what happens if the response is gone back to the client and he requests for another page using the same session state, the load balancer at this point decides that, okay, this is at this point web server 1 is busy, so web server 2 is free, so I will redirect the load to the web server 2. So at this point what happens is, since his session is created in the web server 1, this will have no knowledge if it is in proc session state, right? So somehow this server needs to know that the user is already authenticated and is available, and the session is session state is available for this given user. So to do that, so what you need to have is a common place where both these instances can share a lookup for the session state information, and that's when the out of proc session state will be more useful. So in this case you can go with another database based session state and maintain that. So that's one of the key thing. When will we use the out of proc session state versus in proc session state? So web garden scenario, in proc session state is completely fine, whereas when it comes to the out of proc or web farm scenario, this is the best example where we go with the database route of session state. Okay, so both of these are supported in ASP.NET, and you can switch from, we'll talk about that again in the next slide anyway, okay? So this is exactly what we are trying to talk about. So the session state mode wise, we have in process, the state server, and the SQL server. So in process is the default option, the in proc in other words, and in this case when you say in proc, the session state is it's going to be stored on the same server's memory area, and when you say state server, so you can also this is both of these are out of procs, both of these are out of proc, since it's out proc and in proc, in other words, I'll just name it as out proc, where in the state server, this can be on, the session is going to maintain on a server memory, but as a centralized dedicated server or to handle only the memory. So you can switch to a given server to manage the servers. In the web farm scenario, you can still use this as an option. So the drawback with this is that it's not going to be persisted if the server get crashed, because it's going to be in memory of the respective server, okay, and which is volatile in nature. If the power, if you shut down the power, or if someone recycles the app pool, then the memory in the session will be get lost. Whereas the last and final one are in the out of proc side is the SQL server, wherein you can switch to a database which is specific to SQL Server database and maintain the session inside a database. So this was not going to be lost in any case, because every time you access this session, it's going to be available, persisted as just like your transactional database model. And every action will be recorded into the database, and this is the last best option wherein you would like to choose to track how many users are coming in or going in, what kind of activity the user is doing, all that you can record within the SQL Server session state, and this is going to be permanent. Of course, for this, since it's going to be piling up over a period of time, you should also come up with a purging mechanism to purge if you want to purge a last 5 days of beyond 5 days of session state, whatever expired sessions you want to clean them up at a given interval. So otherwise, the database can pile up and grow beyond its size. And the last one is a custom, wherein you can switch any of your customized store. For example, if you want to go with another third-party managers, for example, it can be another database altogether. You can switch to your Oracle database. You implement your own session state management. All that you can do it using a custom. Okay, so those are the various session state information. And if you take a look at the larger picture of the state management in general, so this is the best diagram that I could bring up, which will show you the various state management mechanisms available within the ASP.NET as well as their scope within each. So at the top level, if the blue box, if you see, that's the topmost picture where in the application state is going to be available. The application state is going to be created when you start the application at the first place, and it's going to be available throughout the application life till you terminate the application. And also you can recycle the app pool. At that point, the app application state can be recycled completely. Unless you do the IIS reset or app pool recycle or terminate the application or restart the application state is going to be there. So that's at the application scope. So anything that you want to handle at the application state can be stored within this place. Okay. A simple example, what kind of information you want to store in the application state is, for example, if you are playing with any reference data in your application, and you want, of course, for handling a large volume of data, especially you would use the separate caching mechanism. And if it is a very small subset of data or any application specific settings, for example, any application specific, for example, you're trying to change the application's title based on the context in which the user gets in or the based on the application context, then you can save that kind of information, or localization of that application can be stored in the application state itself. And that will be available throughout all the users who will access that application. Okay? And yes, so session state is all about, is associated to a given user login. For example, I log into the application, my session will be created, and soon after I log out of the application or the session get times out, the session will get expired and terminated. So this is specific to a given user. So if there is any user specific settings you would like to save, this is a place where you want to stay, save. So the most commonly, this can be used to save the user's role information or the user ID or user-specific information like user name, his role, his designation, all demographic information. So all that user-specific information can be retrieved soon after the user gets successfully authenticated. In typical case, you can get that information from the Active Directory and save it into the session state, so that you don't have to hit the Active Directory every time to get the same information. So that information will be available within the session state throughout his login cycle. Soon after he logs off, his session get expires and it will no more available. So you have to log in again to create a brand new session. So that's how the session state is going to, and when we are talking about the web farm and web garden and infrog and outfrog, so we are talking about this session state, okay? And the within the session state, there are a few more things. So as we see, these are the three different blocks. So three different blocks were actually specific to, actually this is an error in my screen. I should have, This is for user 1, and this is for user 2, and this is for user 3. Okay, so hope that answers. Okay, now it makes sense. So this session state is specific to user 1, and this is for user 2, and this is for user 3. Okay, and that's again a copy paste issue there. So I just copied and pasted there, and that's when this happened. And within the session state, we have a couple of things like a view state and a control state. We just talked about what is a view state and a control state. I hope I don't have to come back again. Again, view state is a very important thing, and I can actually drill down much details into the view state. But there are a couple of very good articles online. If you go to the C# corner, you can see, look for the view state internals, search for view state internals, and you can see a lot of interesting articles, and it's worth spending time on that view state. Okay, so technically, so people do normally ask, where is this view state stored? The view state is not stored, persisted anywhere else. It's part of the page itself. Okay, so as I mentioned, if you talk about page 1 or page 2, the view state is associated to the given page, and I could demonstrate that probably once I have a very good code there, and where I use the view state. In ideal cases, so most of the grid controls or most of the controls do have a view state property. If you enable the view state property is equal to true, then the information within that will get into the view state. So again, that's one of the standard best practice wise. Do not enable the view state of a grids, because the grids are going to be bulky and it has a lot of data. And since the view state is going to be part of your page request and response object, if you try to persist the whole view state inside a page, your response size is going to be much heavier and larger. And if your response size is heavier and larger, it will take this. It will have a heavy load on everything, like a processing cycle, creating the page response, and also sending that over the wire to the client. And in the network wise, it's going to be heavier. And at the client side, to load that heavy response is going to be again a slow down the process. So it's going to have a lot of performance impact on the page. So that for that reason, always disable the view state for the given controls, and do not use the view state to handle any large objects. Okay, so keep it simple and little. So for control state is a completely different thing. What are the property control settings that you're doing? For example, text box dot text is equal to my name, some value you're going to set. The value will actually go and sit in the control state, not in the view state. Okay, so view state is going to be used to check the state change in the state of the page, and there's a lot of information available on the view state. So it's a very lengthy topic. I don't want to overemphasize that here. So that's the one reference point I can give you. You can go and read through that. It's very informative and very important too. Okay, and so this is going to be as part of the page request and response object itself. You can also see the, probably if the page is still running there, I can do a quick demo there. Oh yeah, this one thing I wanted to show you, because this application is running here. There's another thing I wanted to show you today is about the developer tools. If you have the IE, for example, this is IE, of course, and within the IE, if you take a look at this option called F12 developer tools, it comes with the IE, and if at all you're using Firefox for this, the Firefox also comes with the developer tool, which you can actually make use of it to debug your application. For example, I see this screen here, and I can see the HTML content of that given screen here. So I can see the style sheet here, as well as any scripts associated to it, and I can do a profiling on this application. I can, if I say clear the browser cache, not for now, and if I can start profiling, I can do a profiling as well. That's one interesting thing here. And yeah, let me hit this page here. managed department and say stop profiling. And as you see, I can see the respective function calls here and the number of hit count, number of times this function has got hit, and also the time interval or the in milliseconds, how much time each of these things got took. So this is a kind of profile information that can be helpful for you to see which part of your page is actually consuming a lot of time. So all this is available within your internet browser. You don't have to procure any of the additional tools. Of course, there are tools available for profiling your applications. One of the profiling simple tool we saw is a trace enable, which also show you some of the profiling information. In this case, it's available as part of, if it is not showing within your tools or developer tools, then you can actually look for this and install this. It's going to be available for free. And for similar thing is available for other browsers also, like Firefox and other things. And more than that, in this case, we can also take a look at the cookies. Cookies are another means of exchanging information between the client and server. So this is some information that can be available or persisted at the client side in your temporary files, ideally. So once you and you can of course disable the cookies, and it will have the same information that you can put it in the session state, like a key value pair collection, a key and value pair values, and this information can be disabled by your browser at the client side. So it's not guaranteed that if the respective client is going to disable your cookie, then you can your functionality can go for a toss. So it's always recommended to check if the browser, the client side browser supports the cookies, then use it. Otherwise, you have to find an alternative mechanisms like view state or the session state, things like that. Okay, and in this case, if you come to see the source, so okay, sorry, your view source. Within the view source, if I look for view state keyword, so this is where this is the input type is hidden, and this is your view state information. As you see, this is complete in encrypted data within the page, and so by default it will have some of the information available. Some of the information will be carried forward along with the page. So if you have larger data on the page, and if you enable the view state, then the view state information is going to be growing very large, and that's going to hamper your page performance. And that's what I was trying to show you. And I think meantime we also covered the other topic called the cookies. So cookies and query strings are vertically here, hanging here. So these are the two other means where the information can be exchanged between the client and server. Okay, so cookies are like a flat file information stored at the client side. If you disable, if the client side disables it, you cannot use this. But the other alternative here in that case is the query string. So query string can be passed along with the URL. I'll show you an example when we do the project. So it's going to be part of the URL itself. People can pass it with the concatenation of the with the question symbol and concatenation with the comma and other things. So it's again a key value pair completely. And but the drawback with this query string is that it's going to be visible on the browser itself. So that's one drawback with the query string. So if there is any sensitive information that you want to send using the query string, so that's going to be visible on the browser. So so users can tamper that information very easily since it's available and it's editable. So to mitigate those issues, you can also go with the go with the encrypting the query string when you pass it, so that people don't see it. For encrypting the query strings, again, you have application blocks available for cryptography and other things, so those security measures you can adopt. Okay, so we did cover the session state, view state, control state, cookies, and query strings. So these are the various ways you can share or transfer exchange information between the client and the server, and these are the various methods available, and each of these methods have their own usage wise. Okay, and so that covers most of the fundamentals of the ASP.NET. So in this session 31, we did started looking into an overview of our original design and trying to building a project using our original multi-layered design. In other words, a three-tier architecture that we have laid out in the first place. And we did see an application demo mapping to the original design. And then we jumped into the how to create the project from the scratch of emitting the or generating the code out of the EA to start with, and also we did see how can we do a code reverse engineering in using the Enterprise Architect tool. And then we jumped into the ASP.NET fundamentals overview, and we did compare an MVC versus ASP.NET web form, so as an overview, and the differences between them and the advantages between them. And also we did walk through a detailed deep dive into the request processing architecture of ASP.NET web application, and in which context we did also looked into the IIS overview with the version history and the IIS version 6.0 and version 7.5 request processing architecture. And we did see the HTTP context as part of the whole request processing architecture, and also we did see HTTP request, HTTP response, objects, HTTP application objects, global.asax we did see, and also the session state, all those fundamentals we did walk through, and also how can we profile the ASP.NET application using the trace diagnostic information, and the most important, the page life cycle. So we did walk through the page life cycle in detail, and which covers all the ASP.NET fundamentals in this session. So we'll continue with the HR project development in the next session.